Hey, remember to subscribe and follow my podcast so when I release a new episode, you get a notification. And follow me on Instagram. Yes, King Oliver. I am very active on there. Have a great day and enjoy the episode.
Right. Go.
Okay. So, some things that have been really coming up for me these last few weeks, especially doing this cleanse that I'm doing like a full body reset and mental, emotional, physical, chemically, every toxin is being flushed out of my body right now. And I could like feel my cells literally like holding on to the toxins, like, no, where are you going? And so there was some really intense emotional clearing that was accompanying that. And I've been really, really honing in on the importance of communicating my emotions really clearly. And I've had a tendency to like feel a certain way about something. And instead of just like addressing like, hey, this is what I'm feeling, I could be like, hey, careful about doing that because you could hurt someone's feelings, instead of just like being really straight up about it. Which led to a little bit of like upheaval in one of my friendships. But this guy friend, he is super gracious, very patient, pretty calm, honestly. And like there was one day where I probably was literally steaming out of my ears. And he just was like standing there looking at me like, okay, but are you ready to get to the actual like root of what's going on? And so, yeah, I've been really kind of evaluating my relationship skills, honestly, the last few weeks. So that's been coming up for me a lot.
Do you mean relationship with people or as in love relationship?
Well, I would say that if I'm in a relationship with someone, no matter the dynamic, I definitely love them. So both. But right now, like there's no romance in my life, which is something that like is kind of sad, I guess. I really do want companionship and like a dynamic partnership. But yeah, it seems like I have a little bit of improvement to do on my relationship skills, maybe. And that's what's happening with this guy friend, because I'm staying with him and his partner, and they're an amazing couple. I love to witness, you know, their partnership. And yeah, so just like not letting myself be bothered by this like loneliness, but also not being ashamed of the loneliness.
So when I first became aware of things like gut microbiome and toxins in us, when I completely changed my diet, I remember puking up all the time. I go out with my dad to the pub, for example, and I just had to go to the toilet and puke up. And I realise now that it was about my body purifying itself, and it's my own body's way of removing what's inside. So shitting, pissing, being sick, scrubbing your face, it's all like psychological things of trying to remove something inside you. It wasn't like I had any bad food or anything. It was just I was essentially puking out every single bit of toxin in my body, the same as I was crying all the time. I was grieving about things which I'd never grieved about, which I should have done years and years ago, and it was just all coming out at the same time. And I realized now that, you know, disease can't live in a body that is alkali, and the amount of shit I was putting into my body was so acidic that that's why I used to feel sick all the time. And I completely changed my diet to just healthy natural foods. And when you think about how our microbiome is our first line of defense for our body's immune system, and yet we're putting crap inside us, which is destroying the microbiome in our gut, and it's penetrating through our intestine, which is going into our main body, which is causing autoimmune disease. And it's phenomenal when you see how much food and how much bad food our whole world eats, and that's why we've got so much disease. And so this purifying thing, you said how your body's just holding on to it. It's true. If you've like been on a certain diet that your parents have given you your whole life, or that you've just always eaten, like milk, for example, you're not going to your body's going to be like, this is what I've always had since I was a kid, like, feed me milk. And when you stop having milk, it's going to be like, no, I need milk. Give me some, you know, cereals and milk, or give me some tea and milk. And you're like, no, this isn't good for me. Like any drug, when you remove it from your body, you have that withdrawal symptoms, but then you get over it. And it's just, mm-hmm. if you can get through that stage of removing something enough that your body feels better without it, that it's like, oh, actually, I feel really good without this. Maybe I don't need milk in my diet. And I've changed my diet so much that now when I eat crisps, I feel shit. Like, I have 5 crisps a day because of the MSG. The salts were so addictive. It did something to me. It was like a drug. Like, when I was, you know, bullied or upset, I'd have crisps. It was a comfort thing. Mm-hmm. I said, like, 5 a day. And I used to get a massive bag of Pringles or Doritos and just eat them. And slowly, I said to my mum, stop buying crisps. And then I would go to the shop every month and get a big bag. And then when I would binge on it, I'd feel so shit that it would take another 2 months before I'd get another bag. And then it would just get longer and longer and longer, to the point where now, if I have some crisps, I get such acid reflux that I feel shit. Now I don't need crisps as much as I did. I was addicted to crisps. Now I don't need them anymore because I've had them away from my body so long that my body's forgotten about it. And my diet's become so pure that when I do have it, I feel the salts and the shit in these crisps, man. And just thinking about corn and lectins and, you know, corn, that shouldn't be in us, let alone the fats and all the other shit. But yeah, milk starch is in a lot of crisps. And I'm, you know, people have bad allergies that they don't even know they have inside them because of dairy. And a lot of crisps have milk protein. And and so I've always had bad skin. And
well,
I realize
and a lot
now
of
that
people think like, oh, this is just what it is. Like, I just have like a stomach problem. And, you know, they like don't correlate like their stomach problem to what they're eating for whatever reason. It's kind of silly. Yeah. And I've honestly been on a plant-based diet for years, pretty much completely organic, plant-based, locally sourced, like, very, very high quality nutrition. Like, I spend the most of my money on what I put into my body as well as on my body, because this is my best and greatest investment. And so, like, something that's really major right now is soil regeneration. And a lot of people have no idea also that even if they're getting like organic produce, the chances are of that produce actually having all of the nutrients that it needs are so low because of the nutrient levels in the soil. And so this regimen that I'm on right now is all of the products are sourced from soils that have been regenerated, that are like hundreds of miles away from any chemical spraying. And it's really interesting because I am already so healthy. I've been healthy, super healthy physically for years. Also, one of the first things that I noticed when I went plant-based was the fact that like a lot of my like mental illnesses just kind of subsided. Like, I was not experiencing anxiety at the levels or the mood swings at the levels that I was when I was eating the super high processed food that's got all these chemicals that are studied and proven to fire off some really gnarly chemicals in the neural pathway. So I was like, oh, this is going to be super easy. Like, yeah, it is going to be a challenge. It's 30 days of me being like even more strict with what I'm putting into my body. And I was kind of really surprised, but also not surprised, because I know what's coming up for me now is literally the stuff that has not had the opportunity to detox. You know, although I have been really super healthy with my diet for years, there's stuff from like 6, 7 years old probably that's still just like sitting in a corner of, you know, my biome somewhere that's like getting purged now. And those chemicals are tied to chemicals of memories and, you know, all the physiology behind that. And so it's, yeah, it's just really interesting to recognize like the trauma that's being released and all the disease that is like years and years old that's coming out of my body right now.
It's so powerful. Like, if you think about how athletes who did a drug many, many, many years ago, right? Unrelated to their sport. And then they do a drug test for a sport and they get flagged because a minute chemical has come up saying that, you know, this chemical is in, say, steroids, right? Right, that, but that small thing was in a drug that could have been used many, many, many years ago for when he was at school and he had a tetanus jab, for example. And yet that small particle has come up in his urine count, for example. And people who've done, like, say, opioids, whatever, I had a drugs test and I had poppy seeds for breakfast on some bread. And I did a drugs test for a job interview. And obviously opioids is heroin. And it came up saying that I had opioids in me and I didn't get the job, because that's classed as heroin, okay? Mm-hmm. And that was just poppy seeds. So all these things stay in our body, even though we think we've shat them out the morning after. It's deep somewhere in our cell that we have no idea is there, but it is there. It's like if you have like a plant in the garden and it doesn't grow, if you cut it back, it's going to grow, right? But mm-hmm. it takes a while for you to cut that plant back, for the plant to realize, oh, there's no buds, I need to grow. So it goes within and it starts to, you know, put up the buds and then it starts to flower. That takes a good few weeks when you mm-hmm. cut that bush. So when you suddenly change your diet and go to all plant-based, for example, it's not going to happen overnight where you're going to see effects. As I said, I was being sick and I was having rashes all over me. I don't even realize why. And it's about your body's way of releasing its chemicals and toxics and negative energy inside you. I was like rashes on my armpits, my groin, my face, my chest. It's truly incredible, because it's like if you squeeze your body, you get oils coming out of it. And it's the same type of thing. If you squeeze a chicken or whatever, a steak, juice comes out. If you squeeze a plant, like juice or whatever comes out. If you put that plant in a bit of soil which has really like what, like if you've got petrol in that soil, then that plant is going to be squeezing up petrol. So as you're saying, the soil is crucial as well as the plant, because that's going in your body as well. Like that plant is the soil, and if that soil is a load of shit, then essentially you've got a nice healthy leaf, but you're still getting shit in your body, and it has enormous effects on mental health. I mean, it's crazy, because people get all these issues because they're not getting the right stuff they need for their body, so their brain is constantly fogged, and that's where you get depression and anxiety, because you can't think straight. Exactly. You can't sleep straight, and it's just a vicious circle. And
it's so important for people to realize the interconnection between the mind, the body, and the emotional well-being. They are so literally connected physically, chemically, that you can't think that, oh, I could just put whatever I want in my body and it's not going to affect my mentality or my emotions. Like if you decide that you're going to detox physically, that's going to affect your chemistry. Your brain has chemistry that literally controls your emotions and your patterns of thinking. So it's super important to, I think, when you decide that you want to cleanse your system, to be prepared. Like I got ready for a month before I did this cleanse. I knew I needed to be prepared mentally and emotionally for what was coming. And yeah, I really, really encourage everybody to devote as much time as they can to their own personal well-being. Like before they think about anything else, like first thing in the morning, I sit up and I do a meditation. And depending on what my workflow is looking like for the day, I'll do yoga before I ever pick my phone up and communicate with anybody, put food into my body just to make sure, like, okay, I'm checked in. Now let's go.
Yeah, I always joke and I say, at what point did man get a leaf, boil water on a stove, and then he's got a cup of tea, right? And then he looks to the left, he sees his cow Barry. And he goes underneath Barry and squirts his tit and some milk goes into the tea. And then he calls it a cup of tea. At what point did man was like, oh, this leaf mix of this cow's milk, it's really nice. And then years and years and years and years later, we have what's called a cup of tea. And it's like that milk is the animal protein for a cow, right? You don't have a fox doesn't have the milk from a giraffe, or a goat doesn't have the milk from an elephant. It has milk from its own mother. We should be drinking milk from our own mothers. And yet children these days are being given like processed milk from like companies because it's supposed to be healthy for you, like cow and gate and all that nonsense, and they're being given like cow's milk and they're heating it up because it's like the baby likes hot milk. That makes, that's making the milk even worse. And you think about why everyone's fucked. Everyone's going against nature. It's like,
oh yeah,
women can't be seen to breastfeed, or it's not right, or it's not morally ethical, whatever. She's embarrassed to get her tit out. And yet we'd rather feed it a fucking cow's milk and another animal's milk. It's absolutely insane.
Yeah. Well, you know, just like the tea itself, to me, like the first thing that I think about is Ayurveda, which is like, it's Ayurveda means like longevity and Veda means life. It's Sanskrit. So this is like ancient Indian medicine. And in India, they literally worship cows. They are like one of the most sacred vessels. They just recognize this cow for all of its like magnificence. It's a massive creature that could do so many things, right? So food has been recognized as medicine, I think, as long as food has been recognized by humanity. And so it would, you know, be definitely a common practice to consume animal byproduct for medicine, you know, to heal the body. You could put, you know, like a really dense cream on your skin, perhaps, and like the enzymes in the cream, the dairy cream, could help to heal maybe like, I don't know, some inflammation, or I'm not entirely sure about the medicinal purposes of dairy other than when it's cultured and it's probiotic and it, you know, is that does support the gut biome. But again, so then we've got to go back to how are the animals treated? Because if you're talking about how, like, if a leaf is sucking up whatever is in the soil, then you're going to get whatever was in the soil while you eat the leaf. The same thing goes for the muscle tissue in an animal, depending on how the animal was treated and what it was fed in its life. And so if you've got an animal that's been traumatized its entire life, its body is literally acidic. So you're talking about disease can't live in an alkalized body. Now these animals are acidic because they're being tortured, they're being tormented, they're constantly releasing these very strong chemicals, their fight or flight chemicals, and then we're eating their acidic muscle tissue, which our bodies already have an insanely hard time processing, even if the animals are treated really well. So if you think that you can process another living being's trauma and you're not even willing to process your own trauma, like, where's the circle of life? Like, yeah.
Yeah, it's as simple as that. And that's what's so powerful, is that like people have no idea of that, what you just said. It's so simple, it's so scientific, it's just maths. But yet people do the exact opposite. And it's like people should detox and they would see massive changes, but it's not as simple just to do it, because again, it's like it's a system that's set up. If you want to change your diet, you've got to change your kids' diet. And then if they're influenced by what they have by their friends and their family, then their school and on social media, mommy, I want this for dinner. And then mommy's given them a bloody lettuce leaf and some nuts and some olives. Like, there's going to be hell in the household. So it's like easier said than done, because you're not changing yourself. You're changing the family dynamics. And then when grandma comes over for Sunday roast, Sunday lunch, like, she's like, well, where's the meat? And like, well, we haven't got meat, grandma, because the chicken would have been traumatized. And I don't want you eating his cortisol and his adrenaline, because I might kill you off quicker than I do want to, grandma, you know? And so, yeah, it's interesting, but it's tricky. It's easier said than done, but I recommend it to anyone, that purifying, even for 30 days, you'll see massive differences. And you can't go back, because once you feel that good, your body's not gonna want to feel shit again. Like, it's a significant difference between how you feel when you eat crap food compared to when you don't. And I used to feel sick all the time, and I don't feel sick anymore unless I eat crap food. And I used to feel sick all the time. And I look back now and I just used to eat processed stuff, sugar stuff, cakes, microwave stuff, sausage rolls, put it in the microwave. I just go to the freezer and shove anything in the oven, pizzas, sausage rolls, nuggets. No wonder I felt shit. And acid, the amount of acid reflux I used to cough up, man, feeling sick during the night, crisp before bed. It is truly phenomenal.
Yeah, it's right now I do a lot of women's work, and I work with women all around the world, and we do like group Zoom calls and stuff. I've got about 5 different groups that I work with, and pretty much all of us are health coaches or guides of some sort. And there's a really strong trend right now in the health coaching community, which is like trending on Instagram, at least on my feed, and it's like canceling diet culture. And so I've had a few people like respond to me and like be like, oh, like that's promoting like diet culture. And I'm like, no, it's promoting devoting 30 days to flushing my system out to make sure that I'm as healthy as I can be in each given moment. And there's also this concept of like intuitive eating, which is like a part of like canceling diet culture. And I'm noticing that it's a really good scapegoat for binging, because you can just say, oh, I'm doing it because it feels good. My intuition is telling me to feel good. So I'm going to go eat some more chocolate or some more, you know, gluten-free, dairy-free crackers or whatever it is. And you're still like, I know that when I like lean into intuitive eating, I still have the very strong tendency to binge. And so like my intuition is actually telling me over here, and I'm not listening to it because I'm scapegoating intuitive eating, hey, don't do that. Like, you already had enough of that this week. Like, you don't need to eat cookies every day of the week. And I'm like, but it feels good. And my intuition says that I get to feel good. And then my actual intuition's like, nah, girl, like, that's not going to feel good, because after 3 weeks of having cookies every day, when you look in the mirror, you're not going to feel happy. And now you're going to have to like rewind all over again and get yourself back to where you want to be, instead of just maintaining this like true intuitive, like, I don't need to be eating processed food. Of course, it's not bad for me to indulge, you know, but definitely not overindulging. It's can be really easy to overindulge in anything in life.
Yes, I have a rule. It's a 90-10 rule, which is if you eat 90% of natural, healthy, organic, amazing foods, you can eat 10% of whatever the fuck you want. Bag of cookies, bag of Doritos, go to the Chinese, McDonald's. It's not going to do anything to your body, because your body's going to be so sufficient at taking what it needs and just shitting out what it doesn't need. That that 5 seconds of taste of eating, you won't feel that negative load, because your body's not going to really absorb it, because it's not what it's used to having. So you can do that. And we are human, so we have to enjoy a human life that humans have created. Otherwise, what's the point? Might as well just be back in Jesus's day and just live off coconut water and bananas. And also, every time you look around, it's everywhere. Everything you look is advertising. So you've got to be pretty much in meditation and awareness all the time, so you don't unconsciously pick up on the thought to, oh, I'm going to go to McDonald's and get the new cheeseburger. And because that's everywhere, it's hard to be in complete awareness meditation all the time. So therefore, we are going to slip up. And if you don't go through those binge moments, your body's going to want them more. So it's important that when you get a binge moment, you go through it, but you are aware that you're doing this just to get that thought out of your head that you might feel sick, that you knew you were going to feel sick, and you'll learn for next time how you felt. So you've got to go through the motion to really experience that pain. You can't be told you shouldn't be doing it. It doesn't work like that. If you fancy a cigarette and you're saying, oh, I should be smoking, it's going to be in your head until you do it. So if you do that cigarette and then you feel guilty, the fact that you said to yourself you wouldn't do it, that guilt is a more powerful feeling than the feeling of how you feel when you don't smoke. So in the long run, that guilt will actually stop you completely, which is why keeping thoughts in your head is not a good idea for anything, because you need to go through that pain and now make an assumption of, okay, was it the right decision or not? You can't make a decision before you've gone down that path, which is why addiction is so hard, because we're told to stop it or even replace it, as opposed to understanding how the brain works with that reward system of doing something and then letting the feeling of guilt kick in, which ends up being far greater than telling yourself no. Because when you're told no as a kid, you do the opposite.
Yeah.
And for me, the same with crisps. I had to keep eating crisps every time I ate crisps, every time I thought of crisps, to then realize, holy shit, I've just had 7 bags. That is not acceptable. And I'd feel so I'd feel so guilty that I wouldn't feel the need to eat them. Whereas if I'm walking past the crisp drawer and I'm like, Doritos, Pringles, don't eat them. Shouldn't be eating them, but are fucking nice. And all I'm thinking about is Doritos, right? So, yes.
Yeah. No, and even the way that we think, our thoughts can also be considered acidic just based off of the chemistry that they end up, you know, firing in the rest of our body. So even, you know, just doing the thing that you know you shouldn't be doing and feeling guilty while you're doing it, like, I'm a shitty person for doing this right now. I can't believe I'm doing this. I'm so awful. I treat myself so bad. While you're doing the thing that you already know might increase your acidity, now you're adding acidic thoughts to it, and then it's even more so detrimental. So if you can just even like do the wrong thing intentionally, knowing that like you're human and you're going through a learning experience and that you're not actually wrong and you're not actually bad, and you can connect to your pleasure body instead of your pain body in those moments, then I think it could even be easier for you to process chemically.
Yeah, and like what we give our body is just what our body's already feeling anyway. So if you're used to feeling negative, then you're just going to want to, it's going to feel comfortable being around negative people because you already are a negative person. And, you know, if a positive person is around negative people, they're not used to feeling like that. So they revert back to positive people. If you eat shit all the time and you suddenly have a broccoli or, you know, a carrot or something healthy, your body's going to be like, what the hell is this? Where's the salt? Mm-hmm. Where's the acid? Where's the flavor? And your body's going to want to taste what it's used to feeling. But if you flip it long enough that your body doesn't have all this bad, salty, acidic food, and it's used to having like nuts and olives and vegetables and fruit, that's going to be its new taste. Like my mom used to say growing up, you know, have more fruit, have more veg. And I used to have pizza and shit all the time. And it's like broccoli has no flavor, but now I feel so good eating healthy foods that even though broccoli doesn't have a flavor, I would still choose it because of how it makes me feel overall. So now my body is just used to eating those foods. That is the norm of what I'm used to tasting. Because
I love
I've had
the way
it
broccoli tastes.
I've had it long enough that now my body's like, that's what I'm used to. That boring olive nut with no salt on it. That's what your body's used to tasting. I want more of that. Like, we want more of what we already have. So negative thoughts store negative energy in our bodies, which become acidic and adrenaline and cortisol, all this negative vibration that just absorbs and doesn't remove all the toxins in our body. So, yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting too, because I was just reading a little bit last night about adrenochrome, which you, would imagine are familiar with adrenochrome.
No.
So adrenochrome is like one of the most like expensive chemicals on the market, and it's harvested from the pineal gland.
Oh.
So this has got a lot to do with like a lot of what's surfacing right now in the collective consciousness with like the trafficking stuff that's going on. And so children have more pure adrenochrome because the pineal gland calcifies as you age, especially if you're consuming these, you know, really processed foods and stuff. However, also adrenochrome is said to be even more potent in children from like Africa. Just like the density of their melanin, I suppose, supports the density of the adrenochrome. And so adrenochrome is released during trauma. And so what happens is they will traumatize people, you know, to the point where all of their adrenochrome is firing off in their pineal gland and then they will harvest the adrenochrome, and then they will consume it. And it's supposed to have these like insane, like supposed to be like crazy anti-aging, but also you become so chemically dependent on it that if you do withdraw from adrenochrome, like you could like age like in an instant almost. Like if you've been taking adrenochrome, you know, from maybe like 30 or like mid 20s, you're now 70, you've been taking it for like that whole 40 years, and then all of a sudden you stop taking it, you could have like really plush, plump skin, and then all of a sudden everything just starts like collapsing into itself.
So they are stressing people out, so they secrete glenocreme or whatever you said. Mm-hmm. How are they doing this? Who are these people? How do they take that chemical? Have they got like a syringe in their brain? Is it in the brain or the actual pineal gland? Is it like a gas that comes off the head when you're like the heat, for example? Like how are they taking that?
I believe it's pretty invasive, and it's very much, from my understanding, connected with child trafficking and just like the disappearance of, you know, millions of children.
So that's the thing with anything. I believe if you weren't born with it, your body doesn't need it. And if you give your body something that it wasn't born with, it will adapt as if it's got it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when you don't have it, it's going to not know what to do. It's almost like if you give a plant lots of sun, it's going to grow. But then if you take that sun away, it's not going to know what to do because it's got all these branches and life that it's trying to grow. And you've taken the sun away and it's like, now what do I do? And now you just got these big, heavy weights of branches that can't do anything. So you could say you vitamin C man-made, you grow a plant in a laboratory, give it fake sun. You give ourselves all these creams and stuff to, you know, help the aging process. But it goes against nature. So our body mm-hmm. will adapt and grow like it's supposed to with it, even though that could have been a long, long, long time ago that we had it, like vitamin C, because we don't have it anymore. So we give our body collagen and vitamin C because it helps with the skin process. But as you get older, as you said, our body, if you stop taking this stuff, our body goes back to what it was like without it. And like a drug, if you sniff cocaine, you're going to give your body, or even if you have caffeine, you're going to give your body this extra energy, this extra power, this extra neuro connection with life that you'll reach those heights, but only because of this drug. And then you come off it, now your body's not going to know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually dangerous giving ourselves all these extra stuff which have short-term effects, because nothing has a long-term effect. No cream, no drug, no special skin thing, nothing. Vitamin C, vitamin D, if you weren't born with it, it's not going to have any long-term implications. Like if you imagine when you marinate a chicken, you like marinate the sauce into the skin. If you put creams on our body, it's just going into like the top layer, and then you wash it off, or your skin shreds it like a snake. It's not going to change the cells underneath the skin, which end up creating new cells. It might affect the top, but make it smooth. It's not going to have long-term effects.
Actually, though, your pores go directly into your bloodstream. So although it's not going to be completely absorbed into your system, it is, especially if whatever you're putting onto your skin has any chemicals in it, that's going to go into your blood. There's no stopping it unless you put some oil that's like really high on the comedogenic scale, which essentially means that it like seals the pores. Well, then if you put something that seals your pores on and then you put a cream on top, then it won't go into your skin. But if you're just putting it like directly onto your dry skin, say you just got out of the shower and, you know, maybe you're using like Olay or one of these like very commercialized brands, like I 100% guarantee that is affecting your body's chemistry, because your skin is your largest organ and it literally absorbs everything. And that's actually, before I went plant-based, I started using natural body products, because I was just thinking about this last night. I remember as a child, if I put lotion on my face, just like regular body lotion, my face would burn. Like I like just completely heat up and I couldn't do it. I had to go wash it off immediately. And then if I use just like really commercial and cheap body wash, I would get eczema. I would get, you know, dry rashes all over my body. And so I would like complain to my mom. I'm like, Mom, like, this stuff is not good for me. Like, I know that we don't have a lot of money, but I, like, what is it? Are we going to save money by me having to go to the doctors all the time because of the reactions that I'm having to these chemicals? Or maybe we would save money if we invested a little bit more into what we were putting into and onto our bodies. And so I actually like started boycotting Walmart at 18 and would like refuse to shop at Walmart. And my sister specifically was like, yeah, good luck making it through life without Walmart. And I like looked at her and I looked at my mom and I said, my body is the quality that I put into it. So I want to have a quality over quantity life. I'm not going to shop at Walmart. But
yeah. So, you know, it, so when I said that, it doesn't have an effect on the body, as in creams will never make the body younger. It's younger when you're using it, mm-hmm. but it doesn't have any overall effects if you stop using it. However, as you said, it is absorbing it. It has, will have negative effects, but it won't have positive effects.
Correct.
Your body won't suddenly start aging slower because of this cream, because you're not genetically, wasn't born at birth. It will have the opposite effect. Like we're told, don't draw on your skin at school because mm-hmm. your body absorbs it. And I'm like, oh, it's not going to do shit. Now I understand that if I draw my finger, it's going to go into the blood and go around the body. Which like brings me on to tattoos. People are having tattoos, right, on all more parts of the body now than, let's just say, they used to. That is ink. Now, do you reckon that's having an effect on people's blood? Because you're putting ink in your body, it's going into your blood. I mean, ink's man-made, let alone, you know, cigarettes and e-cigarettes, all that fluid that people are... I mean, it's healthier to smoke a cigarette, right? It's healthier to smoke a leaf than to smoke all this
chemicals.
Toxic,
yeah, chemical, totally.
Fucking blueberry, apple, raspberry, water vapor, chemical shit. Like, I mean, Jesus Christ, it's like one problem creating another. It's just typical of life. Problem, solution creates another problem. I mean, you know, Johnson's baby oil, women using it to, for their vagina, or talcum powder.
Oh, no.
No, 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 no. Like talcum powder, people are saying they've got cancer because of Johnson's talcum powder and all that type of shit. And it's like, what do you expect? It's a man-made chemical. You're putting it on your vagina. I mean, that goes for all creams. And then you realize this is just life, man. This is life. And you're not going to change it. The only thing you can do is just put yourself first. And if man has created it, stay away, right? As I said, 10%, we are part of man. You can have Dominoes, you can have Doritos, you can have creams, you can have a joint, because we're human. Like, you have to live a human life. But as long as 90% is natural, natural foods, natural sunlight, natural sleep, natural air, the 10% is not going to do anything. But you cannot change the way the world is going. Like, you can boycott Walmart, and then you got to boycott every fucking other company because they're all working together and doing the same, to the point where you won't be able to go anywhere anyway. You'd just be a fucking monk in a jungle in a shed with no one apart from some fish.
It's been like that sometimes, honestly. Like, I'm definitely like a devotee to what I value, and so I don't go into extremism because I know that can also be kind of dangerous, but I am definitely very, very disciplined. So I pretty much just, I do as much research as I can. And when I don't know 100% what's going on, I just don't beat myself up about it pretty much. And something else that was kind of coming up for me was that there's this like, we can stimulate our body chemistry. And so when I think about using different products or different nutritional supplements or whatever it is, it's not so that I can become chemically dependent on it over time. It's so that, like, if anything, my cells can gain like the memory of maybe different kinds of chemical reactions. So if I want to increase the longevity of my serotonin production, then I'm going to participate moderately in different activities that increase my melatonin, which will support the increase of my serotonin, but not be like solely dependent on it to the point where if I don't participate in those activities, I'm not going to have any serotonin for the day, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so if you give your body, let's just say you've gone grey at, say, 18, right, because you've got lack of melatonin or whatever that chemical is, and then you take a man-made melatonin, and then your body starts to stop having grey hairs. And you, is it melatonin, that grey hair thing?
So that's melanin.
Right, melanin, right. So your body has, like, more melanin. So now you start creating your natural hair colour. And then once you, say, create more melanin, you create all the other chemicals. For example, you said if you create more melatonin, you get more serotonin, and then you get more dopamine, blah blah blah. So now your body's like created this new life of, okay, I've got all this serotonin, all this, and then you stop taking, say, that thing that stops gray hairs, and your body is it's screwed. And now it's going to have other issues because it started to do stuff that it was never born with. And this is the reason why I don't think that people who, for example, are born poor are ever likely to get out of it, because you can, it's all to do with your biology, right? The rich get rich, the poor get poorer, not because of politics, but because of the vibration of their cells, right? If you are born in a low vibration place, it doesn't matter. You could have Richard Branson, Steve Jobs, Trump mentoring you, but your brain activity, your energy, which you vibrate at, hasn't got the processing power to absorb all the knowledge that you would need in order to fucking even start a business because of the energies of that area. And over time, over evolution, you might, your ancestors might become leaders from followers, but it takes a long time. And nowadays the whole world's becoming one, so we're trying to kind of get China up to America's standard, and India, and fucking Iran and Syria and Russia. We're trying to make every human being equal, right? Eat the same foods, know how to do this, brain activity this, and it's just not possible because America, say, could have been around for, say, 300 years. Then they've got Africans going to be around for thousands of years. So their biology, like, for example, the reason why they could be black and Americans are white, for example, is because they've lived in the sun for so long over years that their skin, every single time they have a new kid, gets blacker and blacker and blacker, can absorb the sun easier, so it doesn't get burnt, and so they don't die, right? Whereas Americans, for example, they may have, say, not been around intense heat or lived indoors, as opposed to black men living in the jungle, that their skin hasn't been exposed to sun, where it hasn't changed the pigments. So the evolution of, say, a black person compared to a white person, it's completely different. And yet everyone's trying to bring everyone the same, eat the same foods because it's commercially viable, because then you can open up businesses around the world and sell them all this shit, Doritos and Coke around the world. And people in, like, the jungle are like, hang on a sec, I'm eating coconut water, mate. I don't want your Coke. And kids these days are like, I can't have peanuts because I'm allergic to peanuts, because peanuts could have been a thing that could have, over time, our bodies could have got used to. And, like, you know, cows, the milk, kids having dairy allergies because farmers in other countries could have, you know, had milk for so long in their ancestors that they're used to it, and then all of a sudden you've got a kid who's not had milk before, he's not used to it. So yeah, I believe that there's another power in play where you can't just make every human being the same. It's nothing to do with rich get richer, poor get poorer because of whatever. It's the energy, the brain power of, say, somebody who lives in a poor area who doesn't have that brain power to work things out for themselves, to think, to solve problems. They haven't got the brain power. It's like a caveman, that all he can do is light a fire at that point. All his brain power can do is light a fire. He doesn't have the ability to solve a problem, like, okay, there's a fish, if I cut this fish and I put it on the fire, I can eat it. Evolution over time will get to that point. So it goes back to your body, fake vitamin C, fake vitamin D creams. And our body's like, well, hang on a minute, this is not going to do shit because my ancestors didn't have this shit. So, you know, it's just business and money. Go on.
There's one thing, or actually there's three things that are coming up for me. One of them is, I'll move through them all.
Write this down in case you forget.
Right. So one is, it's got to do with this, like, it's becoming a little bit more commonly understood, especially within like the nutritionalist community, is the importance of the food that your ancestors ate is a lot more bioavailable for your body because, like what you're saying, is through the genetic of generation, the genetics of generational, you know, formulation, whatever. Like, you know, my ancestors probably ate a lot of potatoes. Like that was probably their starch of choice, where as opposed to other people's ancestors, maybe it was like rice or something. So I could eat probably a shit ton of potatoes and be totally fine because that's what my ancestors processed. So my body is like designed
and to process pasta and bread and all carb stuff.
Exactly. So when I think about eating starches, you know, like, because I don't typically like to eat starches because it does basically create like cement in your arteries. If I do eat a starch, it's most likely going to be a potato, most likely a sweet potato because it's going to be a little bit more complex of a carb rather than just like a really starchy carb. And so, yeah, like even getting into the herbs and the spices, you know, that my ancestors maybe used on their dishes and in their foods would be really, really healthy and medicinal for me just in my biochemistry, you know, because when you live in harmony with the natural world, which our ancestors were pretty much all doing up into like modern industrialized eras, they were already healthier for the most part. You know, people were thriving. You could call us a first world country, but the majority of the people in first world countries are miserable. So I'm kind of like, scratch that. Next, let's go back to learning from our ancestors. The other thing that was coming up for me, maybe it was just two things, was we were kind of talking about sunlight and I had just like a really wonderful example for like the need that we have as living creatures to be connected to the elements. And I have this basil plant that I am growing, and this is my first time growing a plant completely by myself. And what I did was actually I bought some organic basil from the grocery store and I snipped the bottoms and I put them in a glass of water so they could propagate and grow roots. And I had them on my windowsill for like a week or almost 2 weeks. And they were kind of like, there was one little bud that was like trying to pop up at the top of one of them, but they were not growing roots. And I'm like, what's going on? Like, why aren't these growing roots? And I realized, yes, they're on my windowsill. Yes, they're getting sunlight, but the window had been closed the entire time. So they weren't getting any fresh air. As soon as I opened that window, I opened it for a couple of hours. Within 3 days, roots were growing like crazy. It was so beautiful. And now I went to the neighborhood. I just like walked up the street with like my little pot and went under a tree where I could see that the soil was really dark and there's some bugs crawling around in it and some fresh fallen pine leaves. And I just filled my little pot up with dirt from the neighborhood. And now they're like totally growing even more. And it's so beautiful too. I'm like a plant mom officially. Although I've farmed for many years, I've never had like my own plant. So this is exciting. And then there was one more thing that was coming up. And it is the sunlight and our relationship to the sun. And we are basically told, like, don't connect with the sun, like hide from the sun. Don't look at the sun. Don't be in the sun for too long.
Cancer. However,
what was that?
Cancer, skin cancer.
Right. Which, as we know, and hopefully anyone who watches this that doesn't know can understand that the cancer can't live in your body if your body is thriving. If you are alkalized, if you are...
disease. Yeah. Disease.
Exactly. So, but also, your eyes are where you perceive the most light in your body, right? That's like the technology of the eye in the human body is to like take in light, take in information, code it into visualizations and images and whatever else. And the more union that you have with the sun directly, because there are different times throughout the day that it is perfectly safe for someone who's new to it to look at the sun and not have any damage. And it's going to be the first 30 minutes after the sun has come up and the last 30 minutes of the sun being in the sky. It's not going to harm your eyes. You can look directly at the sun and it's actually going to increase your melatonin, which supports the increase of serotonin and also tells your body how much melanin to produce. So it's supporting all three of those chemicals just by engaging with the sun. And then once you look at the sun, you know, enough times during the morning and enough times during sunset, then you might be able to look at it directly like midday. And I've gotten to the point where I can look directly at the sun at like noon for 15 seconds, I think was the longest. Completely eyes wide open. And I'm fine. I really know that I'm not going to go blind from it. And there's so much information in light. And so your body chemistry will take in all of that information without knowing maybe in your conscious awareness what that information even is. It's chemical information that you're going to now process chemically, which will, you know, increase your resonance, basically.
Okay, I need to do some research on that because I haven't debunked that. We're told not to look at the sun. I've not thought about that. So I'm going to do some research on this. Like, there's a sunset where I live, which I'm probably going to go to tonight, where just as it's dipping over the horizon, you can literally look at it because it's not the sun. Like, you can see it. And I was thinking last time, wow, I was looking at that and my eyes didn't hurt. And I'm thinking about, you know, when's the last time I looked at the sun? And the answer is probably never, because we're told, you know, don't look at the sun. And so, yeah, that's very interesting. I need to do some homework on that. Can you look at the sun without it causing damage? And technically the answer is yes, because everything is from the sun. You know, people get skin cancer. People in our country, they will go to the beach and they'll sit on the beach for 9 hours. And that's why they get cancer. If you put food in the oven or put food on a campfire or leave like your toast in the toaster for longer than it takes to cook, it's going to fucking burn. But if you just put it in the oven, exactly. That's why people get skin cancer, overexposure of the fucking sun. If I don't wear sun cream, okay, but I don't spend like 9 hours in the day in the sun. I will just be out doing what I'm doing and just doing what I'm doing. I'm not doing it to get a tan or whatever. I'm just out, right? And your body adapts. The pigments change and it can adapt. If we have sun cream, our body doesn't have a chance to adapt. If you give yourself bloody flu vaccines or medicine, antibiotics when you're ill, your body doesn't create its own defense for when it happens next time. So next time a flu does come around, it's like, what the fuck is this? Like, I've never seen this before. Mm-hmm. And so now need like this flu jab to help you. That's why people get skin cancer, because of the amount of sun they're getting, not because they should be wearing sun cream. And I tell my mum this all the time: if you're obsessing over that mole because the doctor says moles are more likely to get cancer, and you're focusing on it so much and you're creaming it up and looking at it, it's going brown, it's getting hairy, you're going to drive that, it's going to become a reality. Your mole is fucking cancer. And my mum actually my mum manifested that cancer in that mole. So it was a small bit of cancer. It was melanoma. And I tried to explain to her, that is just what the doctors call cancerous cells which have malfunctioned. It doesn't mean that's going to spread to the rest of your body and you're going to die of cancer. Mm-hmm. If you just let that mole there, your body would have, your white bodies, antibodies, whatever, would have just taken that down like normal, scooped it up. And he would have never even known it was there, okay? Mm-hmm. But under a microscope that a man has made, he's seen, this is cancer, this is not. Oh, that's cancer. Right, we need to do this. You need to pay for this, pay for that. Have we got health insurance? Nope. Well, we can do this on a plan. You know, fucking drives me crazy.
For them, it's definitely a money scheme. I mean, I think that at this point, it's like common sense to understand that the big medicine industry is really not for our well-being.
I was telling my mum today, I do not check my bollocks for cancer, because if you look for something, you find it. A person who tries to lose, no, a person who tries to lose weight, okay, doesn't end up losing weight, because what you lose, you find. They stay the same size. So you're supposed to imagine your perfect vision of what you want to look like, change your diet, you know, do the things that you know you should be doing anyway. You don't try and lose the weight by cutting half the meal, because your body's going to be like, hang on a sec, I'm used to being full up and you've only given me half. So now it's going to have in your head all night, eat more, eat more, eat more. And now you're going to binge more and get fatter. So when you're trying to lose the weight, you find it. If you test your bollocks for lumps and test your breasts for lumps of cancer, what you're saying is that cancer exists in the first place. In the natural world, disease already exists. And I'm like, mum, you've got to understand that disease does not exist in a body at ease, right? If you're checking for something, you believe it exists. And every time you feel a lump or whatever, your body's going to be like, oh my God, what was that? It's my fucking scrotum. But you think, oh my God, it's a lump. So now you're like, oh my God. You get that negative vibration of, oh, I felt a lump. Oh shit, I've left the gas on. That feeling of like, oh my fucking shit. Like I left my child at the bus stop. That feeling, that toxic energy sends through your body, which creates disease, puts your body in an acidic negative state, which is the perfect breeding ground for that lump on my bollocks to grow. And if, for example, I get a lump of my bollocks, right, and I end up dying from it, what I'll say to myself is, with all the knowledge that I know, if that happens, God's in control and there's nothing you can do. If me, with all my knowledge and my wisdom and my sleep routine and my happiness and my water and my diet, if I get a disease like that to the point where I'm going to die, no one else has a fucking chance, which means I don't have a chance, which means I don't give a shit, because I don't want to live a life where I'm dependent on man to keep me alive, you know, fearing this next thing. I'd rather fucking die.
That's exactly like that. That's the point that I made to my mom and a few other people about COVID, which is like, honestly, I don't even like to say the word. I'm like really not about it. But I've told some people, especially I was living with an elder woman for some time, like a month and a half ago. And she was so, so concerned. She had basically locked herself inside of her condo for like months, you know, to protect herself. And for me, when I think about that, like your immune system is designed to adapt. So if you allow yourself to receive something, which is what a vaccine would do anyways, is introduce your immune system to the biology of it so that it can adapt. If you just allow yourself to vaccinate naturally by going into the environment where this thing might be present, you know, and trusting and knowing that your immune system is thriving and you're vital, then you're going to naturally vaccinate. Like you're literally going to have the immunity the way that we're designed to do. We are so highly advanced in our design as humans. It's absolutely insane. It's so beautiful to learn about and observe. But I was just telling her really straight up, I'm like, whether I wear a mask or not, if I'm meant to die from this, nothing can stop that from happening.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is that disease, flus, they want to thrive and survive. They don't want to kill the host. They want the host to live so it coughs and spreads it. So killing people has nothing to do with the virus. The virus is not killing people. It's people's weak immune system and their inability to fight off foreign pathogens, which is why they're dying, which is because of their lack of sleep, their stress, their diet, they smoke, water, they drink alcohol, they don't drink water, they're sexually frustrated, they're in an unhappy marriage. That is why people are dying. It's nothing to do with COVID. COVID could be HIV. It could be a cold. It could be the flu. It could be a fucking spider bite, right? I got bitten by a spider. I was taken down for 3 weeks and I've got the strongest immune of anyone, right? And that's why people are dying, because they've not got a strong immune. It's not with the COVID. It's something that, for example, if you've got a weak immune system, your respiratory system is going to be really weak because it's like your major immune system, right?
Right.
So, and because this attacks the respiratory system, then if you've got a weak respiratory system, you're more likely to die, as opposed to if it was to attack your asshole and you've got a big asshole, then you're not going to likely die from it. But the thing wants to live and its host to survive. Right. Killing it is the opposite of nature. So it's nothing to do with the virus. It's to do with the people. And all the fear that people are putting into their mind and their body of this thing is, fuck me. you're literally putting yourself in a breeding ground, waiting for that thing to take you down. Like, the stress, the fear is gonna kill you more than the fucking virus was. And
exactly, and that's what's happening, you know, with I think a lot of the cases too. I've watched some videos with some frontline nurses, and they're talking about people coming in with anxiety symptoms, like very intense anxiety symptoms. And at this point, they're just now labeling pretty much any symptom as a symptom of COVID, because then they put you in the room with the people who do are actually carrying it. And because you're in a weakened state, you're that much more vulnerable, and then you're that much more likely contracted as well. And then they put you on a respirator, and then they siphon money from you and your family, and then you die.
Exactly. This is why I say, if you go to the doctor once, you're going to be going to the doctor forever, right? It's a mindset of the doctor can heal it. And when you go there, you end up creating other diseases from patients in the room. And all the doctor does is he looks on his system, types in the symptom, cough, you know, sore throat, and it comes up with all this other nonsense, COVID, blah, 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 blah. And then it's like, okay, what's the solution? Therapy, medicine, injection, what would you prefer? I'll have some tablets, please. No problem. He prints his receipt, he goes to the shop, and then you get given your tablets, and then the healthcare insurance ends up buying it from the pharmaceuticals. And it's just like, oh, for fuck's sake. But
and also at this point, again, it's something where it's like, if you decide you want to look into it, you'll find the information easily, that the doctors prescribe the medication that they are essentially sponsored by. And so, yeah, they literally will just type in a symptom, and up on their screen will be like, if you prescribe them this medication, your check's going to be that much bigger. They probably don't need that medication, because you could really guide them to increase their immunity naturally, but that's not going to cut your check bigger. So we're going to prescribe them this medication that's sponsored by Bayer or Monsanto, which are at this point now the same thing. So it's like, now the people that are making our medicine are also growing our food, which are causing the disease, and they're chemically dependent on each other. We couldn't have big agriculture without big pharmaceutical. We couldn't have big pharmaceutical without big agriculture. And what really gets me is, you've got all these guys with so much money that could be the heroes. They could literally be the heroes. They have all of the money, resources, everything that it takes. The technology is there. It's advanced enough for us to live in complete harmony technologically and with nature. We could have ecological architecture. We can have ecological economy. We can have everything to the point where we are 100% thriving as a species on this planet that supports life without question. If we lose our chance to be here, it's absolutely not because the Earth said so. Well, maybe the Earth will say so after it gets tired of our shit eventually, you know, but also we could just get our shit together and get these people that are holding a lot of the power to recognize how much they would actually benefit from taking care of life on Earth.
Well, I want to stop this so we can have something to talk to next time, and we can lead on from this next time. Plug anything you want to plug, any websites.
Okay, cool. Yeah. My Instagram is Morganic with 2 R's. Also, my YouTube channel is Morganic with 2 R's. I have my website, which is tribalcity.org. I do Reiki. If you are physically, you know, nearby, I also do massage. I do yoga, channeled meditations, just intuitive spirit guidance. And also right now I am preparing to hold my first ever men's group. So in October, actually, I'm going to be holding a 5-session men's group. They're going to be 1.5 hour sessions each. It's going to be a small group. I think I'm putting the max capacity at 6 men because I'm only 1 woman, and I'm going to be holding space for the masculine to rise into, you know, their divinity more or less. And I'm super excited. I'd been kept awake, you know, night after night after night, like wondering, you know, where's the masculine waiting for the men to show up. and wondering, like, where are the men's groups? How can I refer my guy friends to these men that are holding space for men? And then eventually, like, two nights ago, I could not fall asleep until I wrote it down. My guides were like, Morgan, you are 100% qualified to hold space for men, too, because I do hold women's groups. So I was like, okay, I guess if I want to see it, I've got to be it. So, yeah, it starts on Thursday, and I'm super excited for that. I'm also going to be simultaneously co-facilitating a women's health reset through October as well.
Right, I'm going to stop that. Wait there.
If you've enjoyed this episode, I have many more for you to listen to, so go back and have a look at the old ones. Also, make sure that you have subscribed and notifications are turned on so you know when I've released a new one. Follow me on Instagram. Yes, King Oliver. Have a great day.